So moving right along, from one of life's pleasures to another, we're now going to focus on music. And I think Shakespeare said something like this, if music be the food of love, play on. So we are in for a real treat. It's a great pleasure for me to introduce our next presenter, and that's Miss Beatie Wolfe. Beatie has been hailed as an innovative 21st century artist with a truly classic style. And I believe that when you hear her speak and hear her music, you will agree with that statement. She's been described very vividly with some other terms, groundbreaking by The Independent, which is a major newspaper in the UK. Beatie, by the way, hails from London. She's been described as ingenious by the Huffington Post and captivating by the magazine Wired. And you'll soon see why. Her career has taken her from being the artist who pioneered the world's first 3D interactive album app for her debut album, which was entitled 8. That led to a world tour with Apple, and she's now co-developer of a new research program to look at the impact of her specific music on persons with dementia. Her new album is called Montague Square, and with that, she continues to innovate. She's releasing it as the world's first album deck of NFC cards. We'll have to ask her what that means. Along with a fantastic musical jacket, which is unbelievable to see. It's been cut by the Savile Row tailor who dressed Hendrix and Bowie in the 1960s. This new album is described as well-made, expertly played, and beautifully sung. Beatie's songwriting echoes the poetry of Leonard Cohen. Her voice reflects mentorship from Wynton Marsalis, and her passion for music reflects her belief that music can be a powerful force for social good and innovation, not just entertainment. So let's give a warm welcome to Miss Beatie Wolfe, who will describe her journey.
Well, I have to start by saying thank you, Dolores. That was the most remarkable introduction, and I feel like I don't really have anything else to say, except perhaps explain what NFC cards actually are and mean. So I'm Beatie Wolfe. I'm a singer-songwriter, I guess something of an innovator, and I've recently been described as a social entrepreneur, which I had to look up myself. And I guess the best way of sort of, you know, the best starting point is to say, for me, there have always been three things that have motivated me throughout my life, sort of three core motivations. And the first is being of service in some capacity. The second is the importance of one's intention. And the third is keeping the parameters open to whatever might inspire you. And these three things have led me to create the world's first 3D interactive album app, a musical jacket, a deck of NFC cards, and co-develop the Power of Music and Dementia Project, which is obviously why I'm here today. So starting with that chapter of my life, how did I get into that area? Because it's not particularly conventional for a singer-songwriter to be interested in that space. So for me, it really began with the wonderful neurologist Oliver Sacks, who I'm sure all of you know or know of, and the work that he was doing investigating, you know, how music can really help a whole variety of ailments, from autism through to Parkinson's through to Alzheimer's. And I was reading his case studies in this book, Musicophilia, and I was totally blown away. I mean, I just reading the stuff that he was describing and thinking, wow, you know, what greater application of music is there than this? And I never particularly thought while I was reading those studies that I was going to do anything myself, but I remember just being so struck. And with Oliver Sacks, he was typically looking at familiar music, so music that was deeply ingrained in the psyche and the subconscious of that individual as a way of unlocking and reanimating and connecting. And the wonderful example is Henry and his cab Calloway. I don't know if you've seen that video, but I highly recommend it. So then, you know, here I was in London with this in the back of my mind, and I find out that my grandmother has been diagnosed with dementia, and she is living over in San Diego. So I think, okay, well, whenever I'm doing regular shows in the States, I'll make a beeline for her, and I'll take my guitar and I'll, you know, go and sing to her. And I'd arrive, she'd be very disengaged, very confused, she wouldn't know who I was, which was obviously very upsetting to see. And after one or two songs, it was like the light went back on and she was there and she was sharp and making jokes and saying things about lyrics like, oh, you swore in that song, I bet that was because I swore around you as a kid, which it absolutely wasn't. But I found it fascinating as well as obviously hugely moving, because while the music was familiar to her, it was only familiar in the last couple of years of her life. It didn't go way back to when I was 8. So I started thinking, you know, and then I'd receive emails from the carers saying, you know, your grandma was so much better after the music. She was so much better that day, but also that week. So that was kind of, I guess, seed number one. And then I got the opportunity to play to a relative in Portugal who was living with late stages of dementia in a Portuguese care home. And what was meant to be a performance to just this relative ended up being a performance to the entire ward of 150 residents. Now, none of those individuals had heard my music, and actually none of them spoke any English apart from this relative. So not only was the music entirely unfamiliar, but there was no lyrical connection to draw on. I was thinking, okay, this at best, this is gonna create a nice ambience. I mean, what's the worst it's gonna do? But I wasn't anticipating the sort of reaction that we saw, which was, you know, people singing along with these songs they'd never heard, clapping, engaging with one another, and quite frankly, it felt like just a regular old performance anywhere. You know, Ronnie Scott's, apart from maybe the wheelchairs. So after that, you know, I was speaking to the manager, and he said, in the 10 years that I've been a director at this care home, that's the best I've ever seen the group. You know, there's this perfect balance between being engaged but being calm, and being stimulated without any agitation. So I fly back from Portugal, and I'm thinking, I really don't want to have just an anecdote to share. I want to have something more concrete. You know, this memory, this experience was so visceral, and I was telling people about it, but I realized that without, you know, I just had a story. I didn't have anything more than a story. And I wanted to take it further, and I felt that it was something of a duty to take it further. So back in the UK, I teamed up with a foundation called the Utley Foundation, a research company called 2020 Research, the Priory Care Group, who provided all the care homes, and the former marketing director of HSBC Bank. And I suggested that we do a research tour, you know, going into care homes across the UK and almost, you know, with the intention of ideally recreating this Portugal experience, but being able to monitor it and being able to document it. So this is what we did. We did a 4-month research tour across the UK. And I went in to care homes, very different demographics, and performed a 30-minute set of original music unconnected to memory, and those residents were monitored during the live performance and then also in the weeks following, listening to the same songs on headsets. And what did we see? Well, I have to be frank, most of the performances I was trying not to cry, which is not a particularly easy thing to do when you've got to sing. But there were some of the most amazing reactions I've ever witnessed, and I've been lucky enough to witness, starting with a gentleman called David. So David was virtually in a comatose-like state, and his family had stopped visiting because it was too upsetting. And the carers desperately wanted to get a photo of a smile or some sign of engagement, and that's what they were hoping during the music. And at the start of the performance, you know, he was asleep, no one could rouse him, and within maybe 10 seconds of the first few bars, his arm starts to move in perfect time to the music. And then I'm playing more, and it's getting more and more energetic. And within maybe the first couple of songs, his eyes wide open, and he's totally alert, and he's really dancing in his chair. And then in a song towards the end of the set, he actually gets up and he dances. So the carers ended up getting a video of him dancing to share with the family, which is obviously a little step up from a smile. And that was just amazing. We had a woman called Anne who hadn't spoken in almost a year, and she was singing along to songs she'd never heard, as if she knew them from way back when. So those two are just two examples. You know, we saw across the four-month period significant improvements in memory and communication. 72% of the residents were responding in meaningful ways, and it was just fantastic. And the report came out, and I, you know, didn't really have any idea of what was going to happen particularly. And then the next day, The Times, page 3. This is the first study of its kind, and it's profound, and this, you know, huge article. And then The Independent followed, and it's a musical miracle. And then Radio 4, which is kind of like an NPR, but it's sort of the top of the BBC hierarchy. They did an extended segment on it, coming into a home with me. And it just kept on pouring in these, you know, these articles, and Forbes calling it extraordinary. And I thought that was the end of the journey. But actually, it was really only the beginning. So then I felt like it was right to start broadcasting this. You know, so when I was going over and doing performances or keynotes, I would bring this into, you know, what I was talking about. If I was talking about the musical jacket cut by Hendrix and Bowie, I would be talking about the power of music and dementia as well. And that was in, you know, Apple HQ in the theater there, through to Wired Conference, through to Social Innovation Summit, through to the Royal Institution. So it was really starting to get a good audience. And I guess all I really want to say now, before I, you know, tell you more about the next steps, is that I'd really like to show you this video that we captured as part of the pilot study. Now, we had to be quite sensitive to a lot of the individuals because, you know, we were being very, or as non-intrusive as possible, so some of the footage we couldn't use. But I think this video really gives a good sense of just some of what we saw.
Grow up, know that I'll make my own mistakes, and if I slip up, please be the rock that doesn't shake. Don't you know we need somebody, just somebody to take our hand. We need somebody, somebody who will understand. When I grow old, please stay by me as I fade. And if I grow cold, please be the flame that holds the faith. Don't you know we need somebody, just somebody to take our hand. Don't you know we need somebody, somebody who will understand. Darling, oh, if I stray from the one that you love. And if I can't speak, know that I'll love you till the end. Don't you know that you're somebody, my somebody who understands. Don't you know that you're somebody, somebody now until the end. Darling, no, if I stray from the one that you love. Darling, no, I won't drift too far from your arms. Darling, you bring me back to myself, darling, no. That someone who will make me live on. Darling, oh, if I stray from the one that you love. Darling, no, I won't drift too far from your arms. Darling, you bring me back to myself, darling, you're that someone who will make me live on. Darling, you're my someone who will make me live on.
Thank you very much. So I think I'm speaking to a lot of people that wouldn't be surprised by this. And it's amazing how, you know, many of us have this sort of intuitive sense of what music can do, and have seen it. You know, I'm sure a lot of you have seen also the power of music. But it's really quite interesting how little evidence there is out there. And for me, you know, what looks like success is to be able to turn this pilot study and this great sort of pointer in the right direction into a world-class study that could sit on the desk of any accountant or policymaker or lawyer's sit on their desk and really make the case for using music in care homes and with for people with living with dementia. And so while this has been, you know, an incredibly rewarding project, it's actually highlighted how much more there is to do in making music and dementia almost a way of life. And I guess what caught the press's attention and, you know, various other people was the fact that it wasn't music that had been personalized. And yet, you know, incredibly, we saw some of the same results that Oliver Sacks was describing with deeply personal music. So right now, you know, looking forward, we're sort of delighted to be working with the researchers at Stanford to really explore this field and to actually, you know, fingers crossed, embark on a one-year-long research proposal beginning in August to kind of make, you know, make all of this groundwork far more robust. So I guess I want to end asking the question, what is it that reanimates people with dementia if it's not the memory stirred by old favorites? And I would like to give the final words to Oliver Sacks, who in the last page of his book, Musicophilia, actually theorizes on this. And he says, music does not have to be familiar to exert its emotional pull, and music is a necessity for those with dementia. So I'd like to think that I'd gone some way into exploring this area. And thank you very much.